Hey, welcome back. Let's go ahead and get ourselves started with session 10, believe it or not, of 120C, 1820C. Today we're gonna do some stuff that I think is actually very fun. It extends the power of what we've been doing very far. In that, what we're gonna do is look at how we can take this whole notion of evaluating elements and trying to understand things about them, whether it's their orientation relative to the sun, or even look at things like the actual amount of sun insulation that's actually hitting the panel. And then adapting its properties based on that. And this is really the basis for all sorts of things we're gonna do from here on out in terms of trying to evaluate the strength of different design options. A lot of it comes down to having some sort of a form or some sort of design proposal where based on the elements there, we evaluate them, and based on those evaluations, we say, hey, this is a good solution, but this is even a better solution. And we go through and try and figure out what we think the range of either acceptable solutions is, or if there's a whole bunch of different solutions, ones that are at least equally attractive, or the ones that surface to the top. So evaluating is really a lot of what we're about in here, because as we start to evaluate things, we have a way of ranking and prioritizing and understanding why we like some things better than other, and that leads us towards optimization. So that's where we're sort of heading today. In terms of things going on, let's just give you the real brief recap. Last time what we looked at was that the whole issue of mapping things, panels, to image colors. So basically, it's kind of a fun, silly thing to do, but at the same time, it sort of gets into this whole notion of being able to just read any external data and apply that to somehow change the parameters, whether it's a color parameter, or today we'll go ahead and use information like that to go through and change those parameters of the panels, like we did also to the heights. Exploring dot products really got to the whole notion of how we could go through and use vectors to get a really quick approximation of the directness of something, which is very useful. A lot of times we can use vectors to evaluate either how directly the sun is hitting us, if there's something like a vector bouncing off us with sun rays, where in turn that vector goes and casts glare on some other object, and we're gonna look at reflections. We can also use vectors to start to understand views. Like, so can I see something? So we can say that, you know, depending upon the vector that's normal to me, either I'm looking at Offa Lobby or I'm not looking at Offa Lobby, or I can see like the Statue of Liberty or a river or some object that's considered to be attractive or not. Okay, or we can say, is that vector blocked, to understand whether we have some sort of blocking issue or privacy issues. So vectors are a really good starting point for how we look at this. But what we're gonna do is kind of continue to look at vectors a little bit, but then move beyond vectors to actually start to say, hey, vectors were a great first order approximation. They're really good in that they're real quick to calculate. It's like very simple, just geometry math. But how we can actually use more accurate analyses, and we'll look at a solar analysis node that uses the same sort of solar analysis insulation to return insulation values on surfaces, how we can apply that to our surfaces, which will be, it'll be better. It'll be better in two different ways. It'll be better from the standpoint that a vector is really only good for a single point in time. So I can evaluate how the sun is hitting that object at 12 noon or 1 p.m. or 4 p.m. But it doesn't really sort of take into account a range of times, either a range across the year or a range across a day. It's only sort of a single isolated value. So insulation tends to be actually a better value. There are a lot of things we look at that are better values. So what else are vector wires? The analysis tool does vector. Think about the other way in just a second, but you know, it's basically, there's a couple different ways where vectors are good and quick, but you actually want to sort of more accuracy. Well, even that, no. The other side is really that a vector really is just giving us some sort of a computation of the directness, sort of a geometric property. It's not really telling us how much insulation is hitting that surface, which we might want to know as we're trying to decide whether that surface is worthy of putting a solar panel on or not. So it's not really a good calculation, it's just kind of a first order approximation. Okay, let's talk about where we are in assignment space. In assignment space, most of you are actually doing pretty good on assignment 3 in terms of all that. It's just kind of fun. A lot of people have turned it in already. If you haven't turned it in, please go ahead and get it in today. We'll be hanging around this afternoon and, you know, to the early evening, kind of, for if anyone's having troubles with little pieces of it. Please come see us and we'll try and help work you through that. We've seen all sorts of interesting variations of panels being flipped upside down. Okay, so Diana was looking at that. Just there's a lot of things about the surface and how the surface was created that determine whether things have an orientation, whether it thinks of something as being up or down. And it really just has to do with the order in which the curves, how the points, the order in which the points were used to define curves, and then the order in which the curves were defined the surface. So they both sort of factor in there. But the solution to a lot of that is to ultimately just sort of, based on what you're seeing, flip the different values. And there's sort of a flip function we'll talk about in just a little bit for doing that one. If you're turning it in for this one, you can submit it to the campus website. That is always what we need to do, sort of as a minimum. But if you can, share a little bit about it on BIMtopia in the design journal, even better. Like some people did that last time, it's a great way of letting other people see what's going on. And to do that, there's a couple of sort of steps in there, but let's just kind of talk about this whole issue of the Stanford Revit site and how you can sort of get stuff out there. So I'm just going to go to Stanford Revit. A360.com. I think you all got invited to it at one point. If you don't have access to the site, let me know and I'll invite you to it. This is the hub that we use for just a lot of the BIM modeling in the different classes. And I even have some new notifications here. Let me sort of see what's going on here. Some people probably want some. So Jordan, Britt, some people have accepted our invitation to join that. That's super. What happens is we have a site out there. So that's for 128. Let me find the C site. There it is up top. What you want to do is basically just go ahead and upload your assignment to, for example, this folder. So if you come to this folder, you can just say upload that file, put it in here. And when you do that, you'll be able to get a URL. And it's really just at this point a file hosting site. You could also send me a URL to, like, if you have a Dropbox account or something like that. That would actually work out just the same. So who's put something up here already? Anyone recently?
Not in that folder because it wasn't.
Oh, no worries.
It's not Norbert's.
Okay, it's in Norbert's folder?
No, but he's looking at
me. Why don't I see Norbert there?
He's in B.
He's in the other class. That's fine. Okay, let's see if anyone else is. Jenna, did you put anything up there yet?
I think so. I don't know if it got into the correct folder.
No worries. Okay, not in there. In general,
like
it should be.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Is that?
Mine is in the main.
In all projects.
Mine is in all projects.
You're kind of hanging out loose?
Yeah, because I didn't afford to put it. Where did you see it, Robert?
I don't know. I can see it on mine, too.
Really? I'm not.
The first one that comes up, assignment two, Diana Barbara.
Oh, no.
Oh, and these are my pinned ones. Hang on, I gotta switch over to all.
It'll be the first one.
There she is. She's proud of that assignment.
What color is that? Is that green thing?
That's just a URL it puts in there.
I was like, how did you do that?
So if we go to Diana's project and we choose that file, we can say, let's go ahead and share this. And when we share it, that's the link we want. You want to make it public, grab that link, and that's the link that then lets anyone go ahead and download and open your file. Okay, so you can post that. Then what people do with that is if you go to BIMtopia. Now, for these practice assignments, I don't think it's nearly as critical. For your design assignments, the ones where you're actually creating bus shelters and things like that, I think it's more interesting to do that. But you can create basically some sort of nice version of what's going on out here. So let's go ahead and take out there. This is like just a little article, and within that article, there's a link to the model right there, so you can go through and post that. But if you haven't played around with the whole design journaling thing yet, it's actually not too bad. What you do is you kind of croak through and you create an account for yourself. And I won't do it here in class today. If anyone's having questions about that, just pull me aside for 5 minutes, or we'll do it at break or something like that. I'll show you how to do it. We could say that you don't have an account yet, you want to create an account, and then it's just a little HTML-based web editor. We're putting some stuff together. So again, for this, I'm not so worried about like 1 and 3, because everyone's going to be doing very, very similar things. But for 2 and 4, which you're about to do, that's more interesting to share, because that's like your own original creations. So let's go ahead and on back here and talk about 4. So 4 is the next assignment coming on down the line. And if you haven't had a chance to go take a look out there just yet, let's kind of pop over and see what's coming. So if I go on over to 4, you'll find a little briefing over there that says there's a soak up the sun as the assignment. You will find that it's due on May 10th, which is actually like a week and a half from now, something like that. So there's a little more time involved in this one. You don't have access to it yet?
Yeah.
Yes or no?
No, it blocked. So we can reach this page, but then we click the PDF to download it.
Oh, it's always that. I always get myself in trouble with it. Okay.
You go to the assignments, you can get it.
Let me hang on.
Oh, okay. On the calendar?
Ah, the problem is the folder's blocked. Hang on. I'll I got that thing there.
In the assignments.
In the assignments when you can get to that.
I'll fix it. Okay, now you should be there. Okay, so either way, let's take a look at it. Here's the idea. In this one, we're going to spend some time thinking about the sun. So what you are going to do is take a parametric structure, okay? And that could be your prior parametric structure that you've already done. You could really kind of come up with anything. There's a couple of examples here that have been floating around in some of the class examples, the parametric stadium. That's actually somewhat similar, like my little airplane concourse, to one of the examples of a given class. But the idea is, you're going to come up with some sort of parametric structure, and we're going to put panels on that structure. Now we're going to evaluate the structure relative to the sunshine. So what we're going to do is start by just evaluate the directness of the panels to the sun. So that's based on what we're doing right now. We're just going to compute vectors off the panels. So here's the sun vector. Go ahead and see how direct they are. Give them some sort of range from 0 to 1 based on the strength of that. Then provide some visual feedback. So that's the whole notion of really putting some sort of coloration on that. We did that a little bit the last time. We'll do it again a little bit more today. So just a little kind of color feedback. We could also adjust a parameter of the surface panels based on these. For example, today we'll look at this whole issue of like this panel that has like a PV panel. It could be the size of an aperture or an opening into some parameter that we're going to change based on that initial evaluation. So everyone can do that. Next, we're going to go through and say, hey, what if we want to go through and use a more accurate analysis? We can use the solar analysis for Dynamo package. To actually do something that's a little bit more accurate. So the idea is here, we'll look at this node, hopefully we'll get to it today, if not, it'll let through next time, where you'll use the analysis node to compute the cumulative annual solar insolation on the panel surfaces. And we'll have some choices. We can sort of say the solar insolation, either we do cumulative over the entire year, we do cumulative over a smaller period of time, we could do peak, we could do average, there's a lot of different sort of variables available in there, values available in there. But we're going to go through and use cumulative annual solar insolation is really our evaluation here. And then basically the idea is we're going to go through and try to tweak your parameters to see if you can sort of maximize that insulation. Okay, so whether it's the peakiness of your roof or just some aspect of it, you're going to see if you can sort of raise that number up a little bit. And at this point, this is going to be a little bit trial and error, where you're going to go ahead and try different values and see what the results are, and then just sort of see if you can kind of push it up a little bit. Okay. For 4 units, what we're going to do is use a construct called the list map. And the list map does this. Up here in 3, we're just trying manually to put in different values and see what the effect is. What a list map is, and we'll start playing with these, it lets you take a range of values and it'll test each and every one of those values and do it automatically. Okay, so automate the evaluation. So if you want to change the peakiness of your roof everywhere from 10 feet to 50 feet, you set up a list from 10 to 50 with a lot of intermediate values, and it basically evaluates each of those different alternatives, returning a value for you. Okay, so using that, we can actually start to programmatically evaluate a whole bunch of alternatives, get a bunch of values, and if you're really slick, you can put them all on like a some sort of a chart and sort of see for all these different values, here's what the result is, and try and figure out where you think the optimum is. Because for most things that we try to like do some optimization on, every once in a while you have straight line behaviors. Occasionally you have behaviors that either zoom up or sort of flatten out. Often things just sort of flatten out where there's a declining return at some point. Occasionally you have behaviors where you get this like local peak and you start dropping off the other side. But We're just going to go ahead and use list map to sort of evaluate a series of those, but that's really just the first step towards doing optimization. Okay, so just kind of did a reality check on that. It sort of makes sense. You got to start with an existing parametric structure. You can come up with a different one. You can use the surface that you put the, the image on, whatever you want. Okay. And basically, we're going to do some evaluation of the solar potential a couple different ways, using directness and using the true computed value. Yeah.
So directness values, that's the dot product value that we were doing.
Yes. That's just, I call it a directness value, but yeah, it's just the strength of this dot product.
Okay.
So sort of makes sense? Okay, beautiful. Okay. You got a little more time on this one, but use that judiciously. You got a lot of things going on for the next like a couple weeks here and stuff like that. So kind of dig in. Got some spare time on your hands this weekend. Start playing around with it or something like that. Not that anyone ever does. But it's not due till the 10th. Okay, so you should be in good shape there. Okay, let us talk about our examples for today then. We are going to, again, look at this whole issue of panel orientation and just really trying to map some things to sort of deal with the idea of the directness values and how strong they are. So we're going to start with 10.1. We'll just look at that issue of color. That's right where we sort of finished up last time. But let's take a look at applying that same sort of idea. See if I can find where I hid Revit. That's where it looks like Revit is hiding for me. Let me close up some of these things. So we have a nice clean slate, and we'll start with 10.1. Too much flashing. I'll go over. Get out to 10.1 and let's see what this structure looks like. Too much flashing. Dispose of this. Looks like the world of Microsoft wants me to install some new things. Okay, so this looks very much like what we had last time. I got my little surface hanging around out there. Let's go ahead and just take a look at this just to sort of refresh. We'll go back over to Dynamo and just kind of take a look at that programming. It's kind of pretty with the yellow. Okay, so again, what we did here is we did some dot products. We'll take a look at that. Mr. Dynamo. Okay, there you go. Let's go to 10.1. Oh, how about even here? I think we're already partially in this example, so let's start with 2A. We'll go back to there since we're already kind of partially into it. The idea, let's see if we can back up to the front of this, is still pretty much the same. We have this adaptive panels on surface function, and that custom function had a whole bunch of stuff in it already, in terms of being able to go through and create the different panels. This adaptive function, or this custom node right now, is going to return not only the list of the components, but the coordinate points. And we'll kind of look at kind of creating some more functions like this. But if you want to take a look at what that function does, just click on that. This is one we created. So it just has our own little logic inside of it. We'll open that custom node and see that what it has inside is just based on the number of panels and columns, we're just gonna use the 0 to 1, okay? It puts up some parameters. We're gonna add 1 to it, so we get the number of points to be greater than the number of panels. Surface point parameter, flatten that. Give me a nice quad on that, flatten that. And then come on over here. Don't worry about that when we run it. That always kind of gets me going. I think we needed that just because we have the surface. Okay, and ultimately this is going to return some quad points and ultimately return some adaptive components. So that should be okay over there. Of course, it'll make a liar out of me in just a second and not quite run. We're then going to go ahead and create another node. Well, actually, maybe I will go back to 1 just so we can kind of do this, so we can kind of create that node. Now, ultimately, we're going to, based on the sun settings, go through and create a sun directness value. And then this is where we finished up last time. We went through and we created some nodes that basically said we are going to go through and have some color values. In this case, it's going from red to blue. Okay, we're going to have a list of that. Red is going to be mapped to 0, blue is going to be mapped to 1, and then based on that, it's going to compute a range of values and just give you this blue to red kind of sweep on it. Okay. But let's go ahead and, I'm going to back off to 1A just so we can show you how we created that custom node, because that's going to be a very useful one for you. Let's go back over there to 1A. And show it before all the custom nodes are created. So, back over, looks like it's already sort of built in there. Just gonna take a look at this one. In terms of mapping the sun directness values, what we're doing is, we're just basically going through and taking quad points. In this case, I did a plain vested, plain normal, I'm flipping them upward as necessary. Here comes the sun and the vectors, then doing the dot product and remapping them. But, that just feels like I've sort of jumped too far from where we were last time. That's all what's inside the node. And what's happening is we're creating a custom node, and it's ultimately kind of making a custom node that's going to have all those values in it. I wanted to sort of look at the issue of creating a custom node, just because I think that's a important one in terms of just really kind of reinforcing how it works. Like, for right now, just watch what I'm doing. Don't go ahead and try and recreate it where you are, because I'm going to do something that's sort of going to seem a little bit strange. But I just want to show you what this looks like. I'm going to copy all those right here. I'm going to put them out there as though the custom node hadn't been created yet. I think I'm over here. Okay, so here's the logic. It's kind of floating around out here at a high level, just in the main node. So the way this basically worked before I set up this custom node, let's get rid of that custom node right now, is I have the sun settings. The sun settings actually get passed into here, into the sun direction. Let me just get rid of that for right now. And then we're going to take the quad points and kind of pass them in too, because we basically need the quad points and we're going to do the plain best fit through the points. So what I'm going to do is take the quad points out of this function and feed them over here. Okay. And now I have this whole node which is going to go through and compute the strength values. In terms of those strength values, what I can do now is now they're mapped 0 to 1, I can apply that sort of color function and work with them there. But what we wanted to do is just sort of demonstrate here how you actually go through and create a custom node, because that's going to be something we're going to start doing a lot of. Whenever we have a very repeated chunk of logic here, like we're going to take some points and always go through and make plain, normalize it, take the sun settings and compute the dot products to get that directness value. This is a really good candidate for creating a custom node. And how you do that is you basically think about where are the inputs and the outputs. Okay, let me zoom back out here a little bit. And if this chunk of the logic right in here is the part that all looks like a custom node, I want to basically be able to take the adaptive points or the quads of points from this function and feed them in. I want to make the sun settings and feed them in. I can go ahead and make a custom node that way. This just takes the sun settings from the current Revit model. We could go ahead and break it there. We could go ahead and include that in there. It just really depends on what you want to have encapsulating the node versus, you know, want to keep outside. But when we want to go through and say, that's our node, the idea is you go through and copy those, or excuse me, you just sort of highlight those. And when you want to go through and create this custom node, it's under the edit menu, actually. Create a node from the selection. It'll ask you to give it a name. So this is, we did this a little bit before. You'll give it a name, like I usually go through and I'll say, what is this gonna be? It's gonna be panels evaluate directness values to sun. Okay, just some name. Typically the form we use is, it's almost like the noun that you're operating on and then the verb of what you're doing with it. It's the way the naming convention usually sort of works. The category that you assign to it, that's just going to be someplace you'd like it to show up in the browser over here. So I keep on calling things CP120 just so it'll show up under that tab.
How do you get those to stay in your...
Say what?
How do you get those to stay in your like default Dynamo folders?
They will. Anything that's in the default library will continue to stay here. If you have things that are added here because they're part of a project and they're opened up temporarily, it'll only be there while the project is open, so what you got to do is just copy that node into the default library location.
Okay,
and then it'll show up all the time. Okay, but it's always a little bit funky on our machines here, just because as you hop around from machine to machine, it may or may not follow you.
So that's just like program files, Dynamo, library.
Oh yeah, in fact, we can even find where that stuff is. Actually, you can see, when I do this, you'll see where it goes to. There's 120, I'll say okay. It went ahead and created, I have this now single node that just takes a bunch of points and takes some sun settings. And what I'll usually do is, just to combat that, I'll say, let me go through and edit the custom node. Okay, that's what the node looks like inside. Then I'll do a little save as. Now this is where you can actually see, this is where it put it by default. So now that's in the default library, but what I usually do is actually save it as someplace else. So save that over to 10.1 or something like that. So if I want to do that, I'll just do a save as. But by default, it'll put it into the default library.
And so when you save it, a custom node, and package it as like an assignment, when you upload it, somebody else, do they have to open up those custom nodes in order to upload them in? Or
no.
If
when you open your main graph, it finds it in the same folder, it'll be fine. If it doesn't find it in the same folder, it'll show up in red. And say, hey, I can't find this node. So,
if you have something that's in red, how do you get that?
Oh.
You just have to open it?
You just have to figure out where it is. So if it's not, yes,
yeah,
if it's not in the same folder and it's some other odd location, it's not in the main library, yeah, go see if you can find it with a file open. And as soon as you open it,
it should
recognize it as being there. Because
okay.
It's just, then it's on its radar, otherwise it's not on its radar.
Yeah.
Okay, so let me just get, I'm going to pop this out to, I'll just say, under here, 10.1, panels, evaluate directness, save that away. So now I have this custom node available, so it'll be over here too. Okay, that's all just the custom node stuff. I just wanted to show you where that came from, just because it's useful to create custom nodes. We'll in fact do that with the whole color logic in just a second here. Let's go back to, instead of 1A, let's go back to 2A, where this node has already been created. Say open, and I'll go over to 2A. So here's the idea. Here I'm already using that node, or the last version that I had of it. I have the sun setting plugin and stuff like that. I've got this nice logic. I got this nice logic, which is basically going from red to blue, 0 to 1. It's colorizing the panels. That's a pretty good little chunk of logic, too. So if you are looking at 2A and you like that chunk of logic of basically saying, hey, I'm going to give you a bunch of values, I'm going to go through and return them as red and blue, as a bunch of red and blue values, I could go ahead and just grab this code. The input will be a bunch of values, some directness values. The output will be a bunch of color values. Okay, and that would basically just sort of always map a range of values to red to blue. Okay, we can do that. If you want to get even fancier, you could say, hey, I'm going to take a range of values and some panels that got returned and somehow map the panels as part of the same node. But I'm just going to do it with this little chunk right here. So that's a good looking little node. I think I might use that again. So I'm going to go through and copy that. Or just to highlight it, I'll say create a node from selection. Okay, and this is going to be color values from directness values. So I can put that in the 120 batch of nodes again. Say okay. Again, this is by default putting it into just the default location. So if I want to change that and save that away so I can grab it a little bit later, what I'm going to do is open it. See if I can open that yet. Edit the custom node. Here's what it looks like inside. You can go through and change things around in here a little bit too if you want to give it a more descriptive names. This could be values to map to color range. If you want to sort of make that very descriptive. This over here, here it says just color, that could be the color values that you're returning. But when you save that away, let's go ahead and save that over to my little local disk. Okay. Put in that same folder. Okay, now what's going to happen is back over in the example, you know, the names are a little more descriptive. So there's this kind of game of trying to keep the high-level graph as clean as possible and really modularize things so that everything's kind of neatly compartmentalized. The good thing is the thing about this color values and the reference values, I can share that with you, and you can use it just as you would right now. And there starts to be a whole library of these things that can be shared by people and used easily. And that's where, when we go to the word packages and we search for packages, that's where all that stuff came from. It's just people just came up with little things, like the lunchbox package is just hundreds of little useful nodes that people put together. So that's a great one just to have, because someone did all that work for you. And in the spirit of sort of an open source sharing community, it's great to share that stuff so that people don't have to go out and look for them all the time. So if you go looking around in packages, you'll even find some old packages that are, say, CE120, because someone who was in the class several years ago actually posted a lot of that stuff and just put them out there as packages to share with other people. So you'll find different things. Now, when you put packages out there, there's always this flip side. Yeah, it's great because you share them. On the other hand, because they're out there in the world, you'd like to say that they think that they stay current all the time, but as new releases and nodes change happen, sometimes they get out of date. So sometimes when you download a package, if it's not up to date, people aren't maintaining it, it may not work. Because people forget to go out and update things that they publish. So if you do publish it, it's kind of implied that you probably will go back and update them. But okay, this is all this color values. So just pause. Color values kind of make sense. That's where we were last time. Okay, math. Yes, Noah.
Does anyone else get an error message when you run the Dynamo with your new custom node for color values dot from directness?
Let's check it. I may get an error message in here because in terms of doing it.
In the main 2A, then I get my edit color values on the far, far right is yellow.
Let's go ahead and sort of see.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Yeah.
Let me run it, and we'll see. Remember last time I was having trouble with my little node, the one that actually created the quad points. So let's sort of see what's happening in terms of whether I need to fix that again. It's back to that one.
Yeah.
Okay.
It is.
Okay.
Yeah,
so this is doing okay. So let's think about what we did to fix that node last time.
Adaptive components and the adaptive panel on the surface is not playing ball.
Okay, so that's what watches are for. Watches are very good for this. So let's go back into this node and see if we can figure it out again. So the adaptive components are there. Last time, I think what you had me do was we just remove the second flatten out of it.
Yeah, that sounds right.
That one right there on the adaptive components. So okay. I flattened the points, but I didn't want to flatten the components. So I think we did that last time. Let's check a look at that. And I'll save that away. Cut back over to 2A, and we'll try running that. But it's useful. Yeah, debugging's a great skill with all this. No, I'm not quite there yet. Oh, it's still running.
Yeah, I got a warning.
So let's see, which one did you just remove? The second button?
I took out the flatten that was on the way to making the adaptive panels. Okay, this is interesting. Okay.
Now, I get the panels.
So far, so good over here. Let's see if we can figure out where the warp is. Okay, I got my panels. That looks like a pretty good list over here. I got my points. That seems to have done that. Let's just kind of follow them through. So if I come on over and let's see what I got here. In terms of my list of the color values over here, let's see what this is looking like. That looks like a pretty good list over here. This warning says one or more of the input types not matching. It doesn't want to take an array. That usually means that there's a list involved somewhere. So I got a nice flat looking list over here of color values. I have a nice, it's right there. You see that the panels are currently, they're sort of in. it's that flatten thing again. I wanted to flatten. I got a really lot of woods doing there, but
it's just
basically we're in rows and columns right now. So it wants to flatten them outside them. Okay, so as is being suggested, as I hear it back there, yes, we want to do another flatten in it. So basically, let's flatten here. So I'm going to take that list over there and flatten them. Or actually, let's be smart. How about, for a change, let's be smart. Let's do this. If I know that that's actually supposed to be adaptive components, but now it's a list of adaptive components, let's go back to the thing where I actually did the adaptive components on the surface, that node, and I mucked around in there, and what I'm going to do is basically put the list flatten right in here. Because if we do that, then if I keep on using this node again and again, then I don't have to worry about changing it everywhere.
Yeah.
So I'll flatten that list out. Okay, now that should have the same effect. I should get a flat list out. You can find that 90% of the troubles we have in here is just, it's this issue of how flat your list is and whether the hierarchy matches what it expects. Okay, I'll save that away. I will go through and come back over here. And now we suspect, let's sort of see, we should get hopefully a flat list of panels over here, and not rows and columns. And then hopefully that flat list and the flatness to color values will get together and have a good time.
Yeah, I still have the yellow.
Okay, let's
see. Yeah, mine says
still the internal. Okay, let's take a look. I'm still running, so as I'm running, let's see what your guys are doing.
Oh,
scroll to the top of that. I want to see if it's a flat list or an adjudicator. It looks like it's all flat, beautiful. And what's happening down here on the colors? The colors is also flat. Got it. And did you rerun?
Yeah.
Watch out. It says it's complete with warnings again. Okay.
Should I reload the element?
No, I got warnings too, so let's start to see. We'll debug this together.
It's just like, I'm jealous.
No,
okay.
They work, but it didn't work.
Let's see.
It tricks.
Okay, one or more of the input values are not matching. It still thinks there's an array coming in here. So let's think about this. Over here, I got a nice flat list. I don't see any arrays in here. Let's just kind of check it out. Do I have the same number of values? I'm going to play all these games. It looks like I have 119 values over there, 120 values.
Okay.
Let's come back over here. I have a, looks like a single list that has all those things in it. Although, let's see if I have a single list or not. Looks like I have a single list. Looks like it has 119 values. That looks like those two things should be okay. So I'm a little confused right now. What I'm going to do is actually go through and just replace the node.
Just the last one, the element override?
Yeah. Every once in a while, if nodes just don't seem to be working, I'll just go ahead and try that. Just element, override, color, and view. Let's just try that. So if I take that node, I take those elements, and I take those colors to them, and I'll get rid of that one. Let's just sort of see. Okay, that time it looks like run completed
that,
and it didn't get it.
Okay.
Okay, so again, watch out for this funny thing. You know, it's an experimental environment and some things just every once in a while just need to be tweaked. So, okay, we got it fixed. Hopefully that little bit of joint debugging was good in terms of really what I do, because there's really nothing too special. It's always go back and watch and really trying to figure out if things lining up one to one. And try and make it work that way. Okay, so I like my color values from the redness values. That was actually pretty good in terms of getting the red and blue. This new node over here that I fixed, the whole one about adaptive surfaces, or adaptive panels from surfaces, that's actually a pretty good node. I'm going to use that in just a second, again, because I fixed it once, and there's no reason I should have to fix it again. So I have adaptive panels on surface. I am just betting in the next example, I'm also using adaptive panels on surface. So it'd be good to copy this fixed node into the next example so that it would also use it.
Because it's still in the example 10 folder though, can't we just reload it in?
It'll
be the new better one?
It's inside of 10.1. It's gonna be in 10.2, it's not in that folder.
Okay.
So I need to put it over there. Or if you're working on your own machines and it's actually in your own like hard drive, then if it's in the default library, the default one's changed, so you don't need to do it that way. Okay, but let's go ahead and get ourselves ready for the next one. So we got some colors, we did a little bit of debugging, but let's see if we can sort of fix this. The deal is, let me see if I can go back to the Mac side for a second. I'm over here in 10. I have been working over here in my 10.1. I created this fantastic updated node called, what is it, panels? That's panels about, where's the adaptive? Panels on surface, right there. I like that custom node so much. I'm gonna put it into 10.2 also because I am betting the same error or the same problem that I'm gonna have is happening there. So I'll put it in that node. That way when I open 10.2, it'll be there. In fact, I'm even gonna put it out here. I always throw along this little thing of, kind of common custom nodes. I'm gonna replace it there too. So that, as we keep on going with future examples, we'll see about keep on having that. I kind of keep a little library of things floating around on the side. Okay, so hopefully all our hard work on adaptive panels and debugging that will kind of come in there. You see, I have a function here called map colors blue to red. If I wanted to, I can grab that other one we just created, which is returning the color values. But let's go ahead and see how it works. Okay. So 10.1 is really all just about the colors. That's where we were. In 10.2, we want to extend a little bit though. Start changing some more panel parameters. So it always gets to the same sort of thing. We're going to go through and choose some panel parameter to change. And it depends on really which type of panel you're working with. If you're working with a rectangular seamless panel, we have the height. But you can't get the height any lower than that, because if it gets to be zero, then you don't know how to make the panel. The aperture panel is, it's the one that looks like a kind of, oh, it's like a Z. It has like borders and it has a cross brace on it. It has this idea of like a wall thickness. The resizable opening, that's the one that has the square opening in it. That can, you can change the opening anywhere from 0.01 to 0.49. So we're just going to go ahead and say we've got some panels. We're going to choose a parameter. We're going to figure out what the high and low values are and remap 0 to 1 or map the values to sort of fit that. Okay. And then set parameter by name. So fairly straightforward. Okay.
Let's go after it.
Okay, so if you go to 10.2, let's see what we got. Should be a pretty logical extension. Okay, so I'm going to open up 10.2. A little 10.2, come on, do your thing. Okay, this actually has some panels on it already. I can tell that's the aperture panel. That's the one that has the little Z cross brace on it, something like that. But let's go ahead and just so we don't kind of clutter it up, I'm gonna take out the panels. Let me filter this just to make sure I'm only getting rid of the panels. I don't want to get rid of the mass. I need the mass to still be around because the mass is actually how it's going to place those things.
How did you get to the filter? I see.
What you do is after you've selected them, the filter is up in the modify.
Okay.
Okay, so I got my mass. That looks good. Let's go over and, oops, not there. In Dynamo, we're going to open up 10.2. Just do this little bit of an extension. Okay, open 10.2. Now, since that new improved value, or that new improved node of adaptive panels on surfaces that I just created a moment ago is there, hopefully that same logic's gonna follow me through. So my fixed logic. That's actually one of the big advantages of, let me go to 1A. You know, doing things in this very modular way is if you start to keep a library of these things kind of hanging around and the versions update and change and you need to fix your nodes, you sort of fix them in one place and it fixes them for all the different things that are inheriting that. Okay, so I have my new improved adaptive panels on surfaces, at least found an adaptive panels on surfaces there. If you want to just sort of verify that it really is that new improved version that we created, I can say edit that custom node. And it looks like great. I'm flattening in the right order. That looks pretty good.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Then within there, we're going to kind of go on down. We're going to map some color images. Here's I got my evaluate panel orientation to the sun. Down here at the bottom, I'm doing something just very straightforward. Down there, based on these color values are going to come back as 0 to 1. Okay. We're going to map the color values using this custom node and kind of do that. So that's going to just put the coloration on it. Now we also want to go ahead and think about changing some values. But let's just try running it the way it is. That should give us, fairly straightforward in operation. Right now you can sort of see it is this aperture panel. The aperture panel, again, it has this notion of the width of the bars. So if you run that, let's just try and run that and make sure that's working. Then we'll try changing it to a different panel. Okay, that's not looking too bad. Okay, so basically we have this aperture panel applied. Right now it looks like all the parameters are the same. It doesn't look very different. It does have the coloration information. If I zoom on out, you can sort of see where the sun is right now. So I think the sun is the red side. The blue side is kind of the out of the sun side. Okay. If we would like to start changing some of those values around a little bit, we're just going to go through and take those same directness values, map them into a range that's appropriate, and then go through and apply that. So let's take a look at the aperture panel and what's available. I'll say, here's my aperture panel. Let's grab one of them. There's that flip which is a yes-no value, which Diana found useful a little while ago. Okay, we can see that this has this notion of a wall thickness, and just so you even sort of understand what it does, try playing with it. I always play with these things manually first to sort of get a sense of, you know, how far can I break this thing, or move this thing till it breaks? What if the wall thickness is 4? What does that mean? Okay, what if the wall thickness is 6? Getting pretty close to being full. I am betting that the wall thickness can be 1. Let's flash around doing something. Okay, let's try this again. I'm betting that it can be 1. Okay, it can be kind of skinny. I bet it can't be 0. Because 0 almost always works out to be a bad thing for us. Okay, so let's go ahead and apply this. The idea here is, well, actually, let's think about our logic. Okay, if I could change the size of that aperture, what do you want to have happen? Would you like the openings to get bigger or smaller depending on where the sun is shining? And that kind of gets into your attitude about whether you want to use the sun or not. Okay, you want the openings to be smaller, so we're gonna get the closing to be bigger.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
More closed.
Okay. So we have directness values 0 to 1, and we're gonna map that into a range. We're gonna map that into, let's say, where it's 0 on the kind of shady side of the street, we'll map it to like sort of 1 foot. On the sunny side of the street, we'll map it to 6 feet. Okay, something like that. So here's how it'll look. We got our directness values. They're kind of hanging around over here. They're coming out of our nice little custom node. Notice how we don't have to go back there. It just sort of does what we're supposed to be doing. Okay, we're gonna do a little math remapping. I'm gonna take these numbers, and my new minimum is gonna be, so wherever it's 0, I'm gonna make that 1, kind of keep it very open. Wherever it is close to 1, I'm going to make it like 6, going to be very closed as a panel. Okay, so we're just remapping the range. The parameter I'm going to change is wall thickness. Those are the values, the new improved values we're going to put in there. And for the panels, I'm going to put in those. Okay, so in theory, we have something that looks pretty good. Let us check this out. Run that. Okay. If yours is run and it's looking pretty good, okay, so I have relatively closed surfaces versus relatively open surfaces. Let's try it with another panel. The rectangular panel with opening.
Yeah,
is a good one. So let's go out and grab that guy. How I'll apply that is back over here in my Dynamo script. I'll just change the family time to be, it's a rectangular panel with opening or something like that. Resizable opening, that looks like it. Panel with resizable opening. Okay, now for it, its parameters are a little bit different. It has a parameter called opening. So I'm going to change the name over there to be opening. And then for the range of values, what? It can be anywhere from 0.01 to 0.49. And again, let's just sort of see what the effect is so we can sort of scale ourselves. I'll come back over here. I'm going to say, again, let's just try it manually. Let me change that over to a panel rectangular with opening, sizable opening. Okay, and let's see what the effect is. If my opening is, say, 0.01, okay, that looks like, let's see, doing it. Next to no panel at all. Okay, so I'm guessing that 0.45 on the other side. Is a very closed panel. Beautiful. Okay, so if we're gonna exercise this same logic, I'm just gonna change the shady side people to be, and it can be 0.01 if you want next to no panel. It can be 0.02, 0.03, whatever it is. I'll just make it really small on that side. Oh, actually, this might take 0.01. I remember that code blocks are a little bit strange in terms of decimal points.
You can't leave with the decimal point.
Okay.
It breaks everything.
Then we will fix that. Okay, so let's try this. Okay, so again, we're gonna go for kind of closed panels on the sunny side. Let's see what's looking like.
Open on the fresh air.
Okay, I'm catching up to you. Let's see what that's like. And if you already got it working, go ahead and try moving the sun around and rerun it. You can sort of, it's sort of interesting to just sort of watch it move. Well, that's interesting. Now, since I only have three panels going across, it's sort of a coarse-grained about what it's doing right now, but we could go ahead and increase the number of panels and get sort of other interesting patterns. This is actually working pretty good. What I want to show, though, is actually how you can change another type of parameter, which is that whole yes-no parameter, which is really kind of interesting. And there's a panel that I think is a really good one to sort of play with that. It is, it's called a panel with resizable, or it's called panel, what is it? It says it was solar panel option or something like that. But let's load it in and we'll sort of find it. Do this if you can. If you're hanging out over there in Revit and you have Revit open, let's load in one more panel type. So I'm going to say insert. I'm going to load a family. And where I put that family was, is it's in the session 10 examples. It's in the custom panels. So go to under, where did Spring go? There it is. Go session 10. In the examples, there's these adaptive panels. I put a new one in there called, let's see if I can find it now, panel with solar panel option. Let's bring that in. Okay, and we'll take a look at how it works. So I'm going to just replace one of them just so we get a sense of how it works. Let's say panel with solar panel option. So this is actually very similar to the rectangular opening panel. Okay, but it has this cool parameter right here. If you put it on, it basically puts a solid panel on top of the other panel, as though you're going to put a solar panel there. Okay, it's a little hard to see here, but let's see if I can zoom in and see it. Actually, in this case, it is. It's just right on top, or is it going underneath?
It looks like these panels actually plug into the underneath.
It looks like they're underneath.
Well, it's just because you have a concave.
No worries. If we're having them underneath and that's not right, we could always go back and do the flip. Let's see what that looks any better. Okay, that looks like it's a little bit better. But let's go ahead now and sort of play around with this whole issue of the solar panel option or the flipping. They both work sort of the same way in terms of what's going on, because you're basically just going to turn on a yes-no variable. Okay, so let's go back over to Dynamo for a second. And we'll change, as opposed to the rectangular panel with opening, we'll change this to be the one that has the solar panel. So come on over to the place where you first put in that panel. I'll say with a solar panel option. Super. Now let's think about what we can do with that. So here it is over here. It's got a parameter called solar panel. So lower S, uppercase P, and it really has either a true or false value. Okay, in terms of what's going on. So if I want to, for example, turn that on, I'm going to say element set parameter by name, solar panel, and the value is going to be true or false, something like that. So let's think about how we can use that. I'm going to come back over here. And we're going to say, again, element set parameter value by name. But I'm going to go through and use a different one. Oops, I got the whole thing. I don't want to do that. I just really want to get element set parameter value by name, just that one little node right there. Just put it right down here. So for this one, it's going to take the same elements. The parameter name is going to be solar panel. And the value that I'm going to put in there is going to be either true or false, which in its language is a Boolean. So let me say true. Okay. Now, so far, what I've set up there would basically turn the solar panel on all of them. Okay, so I got the colorizing going on down here, I got the sizing happening up here, and this is basically say taking all of them and turning them all to true. Okay, so it's gonna turn them on all of them. Actually, let's just try that and see how that works. Then we'll get a little more refined about that. Because that's not really what I want to have happen. But like a lot of things, I sort of test debug things one step at a time, just because it's easier to figure out where things break. So let me run that. Should regenerate those, and hopefully we'll get solar panels going everywhere. And let's think about that. Yes?
Oh, I have a question about code block not letting you change the number.
Sure.
It allows for design script. Does that mean I go out?
Oh. What it is now, it's really just that for point, for the ones that have decimal points, we have to lead with a 0.01.
Oh, okay.
It's trying to interpret it as being like a kind of a noun and a verb.
Okay,
so as mine is slowly but surely chugging along there, let's just talk about what we want to have happen here. Because I could turn the solar panel on all of them, but that probably wouldn't make sense. So, what could we use as a good kind of criterion? Like, how can we decide whether things should have a solar panel or not?
The solar, the amount of solar hitting it?
Yes,
like
okay. So, what would, okay, so right now I got a range of values 0 to 1. what can I do? Yeah. What would be a good threshold where if it was above the threshold, we could turn it on. If it was below the threshold, we wouldn't turn it on.
Well, you want to like short every PV panel that's not full sun. Like even a little bit shading kills it, right?
Well, it's higher or less, more or less efficiency. Yeah, they don't have to be in full sun all the time. But we could say that only the ones at one get the solar panel. That'd probably only be one because it'd be the highest value. Yeah. So we could say we could do it by the true directness value. I have them sort of scaled to 0.1, which sort of mucks the arithmetic a little bit. I really would like to do based on the true insulation value. Yes, Caesar, what are you thinking?
Yeah, just have like an if statement based on either like the true value or you could do it from 0 to 1, but like I don't know how.
Yeah, that's already sort of pre-scaled,
yeah.
Which is not so good. How about this? Let's go through, we can go out and get those raw directness values. Okay, let's do that. We'll pull them out and then base it on that so that only if you have a directness value, that is your dot product. So right now we're sort of scaled, so the negatives are at the zero range, but actually they're negatives. So, okay, let's do that. We'll approach this the right way. So we'll say, let's go to those evaluate panel orientation to suns. Okay, and we're gonna edit that custom node, because we can. We are in power. Okay, so back in this node, you'll see right around here, I do this map rearrange, or remap the range right there. The vector dot products are actually right here. And if I would like to get those raw vector dot products, all I need to do is put another output in there and just kind of pipe them right out so I can use them. So what that would look like is I'll say output. Output's the way I sort of get things out of a function. And I'll say, okay, you're looking good. Let's put you over here. I'm gonna pull the vector dot products over to there. You can have multiple outputs. That's what's really cool. You can set up as many as you think are gonna be useful to you. And I'm gonna say, this is really my raw directness values, or unscaled. I could say, whatever I wanted to call it. Okay, looking good. If you save that away, the nice thing is now that's available everywhere we're using that node. So again, I'm just taking the vector dot and I'm pulling that out raw, only because that's actually a truer measure. The scaling sort of clouds our ability to reason on this a little bit. So just vector dot to raw directness values. And if you have that, we can then go back to the mapping. Okay, so now I got some raw directness values. Okay, so now I know these values are gonna return a bunch of values anywhere from like -1 to +1. Okay, so now what's a good threshold given that? Like the closer to one, the more direct. We could be very insistent, okay, which might be hard. Or we could say, how about greater than 0.8, greater than 0.7? In fact, you can even put a little slider in there and sort of see as you change that threshold how many panels are involved. Okay, but I don't know.
Depends on your payback period.
Exactly. Ultimately, it sounds like it should somehow be tied to that. Okay, let's go ahead and I'm going to set up this. I'm going to set up a little greater than statement. I can do this with a code block, or I can do that with just the greater than node, either way. But I'm going to say that, it's the same sort of thing. If I type it in, it's just a code block. I'm just going to say raw directness value. And you see, I always use very verbose variable names, but it makes it easier. Is greater than 0.0, I'll call it 80. Or if I wanted to, I could say threshold and kind of make it that. Maybe I'll do that. I'll do a little slider over here. Again, don't worry about that. If you just have a number in there, that's super. So I could say that it's greater than the threshold value. And that might be a smart way to do that, just because in the end, you want to be able to compute a threshold value based on the payback period. So you're thinking ahead nicely. See, the maximum would be 1, and it's going to go, okay, I'll say the steps of 0.1. That's fine. So I'll change that to 0.8 as its starting value. So what this is going to do, my little code block, which I've engineered here, is it's going to go through and ultimately return a bunch of trues or falses. Okay, and that's going to be useful to us. Okay, so I'm going to get a whole bunch of trues or falses. Let's just kind of test it out. Actually, as I'm doing that, I should comment, this is a software developer.
Yeah.
That was feature creep you were witnessing, where I started out with a simple idea, and halfway through, I started adding new features that I thought would make it better. Yeah.
Is the absolute value of the directness?
Actually, if we did the absolute value, then the strongly negative ones would also show up. So I'm not going to do the absolute value. Yeah, because it's if they're strongly negative, I'm just going to let, it's the other way. Okay, so let's just kind of test this and sort of see if I actually do get some trues or falses. Again, in the spirit of just walking before we run. Okay, I have some warnings. Not to worry, that's coming over here. I don't know. We'll figure it out. It's like there's something going on. Let's take a look at this. I think we're going to need to just replace that again. But this is going to say that it's going to have a bunch of falses. Can I find any trues in there? False, 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 false. Oh, I found a true. I see a few trues in there. It's going to be very close. Actually, that's actually true. That'll work. I was going to do it in a more complicated way, but I think that's actually going to work, just in terms of doing that. I'm going to lower my threshold down a little bit because it looked like I didn't get very many of them. I'm going to say, closer to 0.5. Okay, but now I have a bunch of trues or falses.
You're going to do an if statement, right?
I was actually going to use something called a Boolean filter, where we can take all the different panels and just filter them into two buckets, ones that map to true and ones that map to false, and then just apply the element set parameter to name only to the ones that map to true. But you're actually smart about, you don't need to do that, because since it actually is based on true or false, you can just actually plug that in directly.
I like to say lazy.
I'd say smart. Okay, so let's come back over here. I'll pop that in over here. In terms of this color, since nothing really should have broke there, and we know that it broke a little while ago for no particular reason, and it was just replacing the node, I'm going to just try replacing that node. Just because it broke for me, and I think it broke for you, and I just don't sort of trust it. Where'd it go? Still broken?
And it's weird because the only thing that's referencing it should still be good.
Yeah, nothing changed on
the
front end.
The color map to blue range, that broke.
Oh, so our sun directness value is broke. Interesting.
Oh, because that makes sense though, because that's what we did make a change to.
Let's figure out what we broke on over there. Okay, so.
It looks like it's now has a list.
What are those sun directness values?
I think we need to flatten that list for some reason.
Yeah.
It's got two lists. Now the two lists there, that's okay. Although there, and at 0 to 1, it should be the sun directness values, yada, yada, yada.
That's close and reopened Dynamo file.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. We've sort of confused it a little bit. And this is, again, I think it's perfectly believable. I'm going to go ahead and save this and reopen it. Because it shouldn't have broken that, but I would be perfectly willing to believe that somehow, that custom node, it's still somehow confused about the result of that custom node. So where am I? I'm right here. Let's open that up. Okay, so Filippo says if we run this again, it'll work.
I think it worked for me.
Okay, so let us take a look then. Theoretically, I'm going to have a bunch of true-false values based on my little threshold of 0.5. These are going to be truly greater than 0.5, not just the scale values. So it's only going to be the pretty direct ones in terms of what's happening here. That should ultimately be setting some of the those values, those elements. And take a look.
Switched mine all to true first, so
yes.
They all had solar panels, and then when you ran this code, it only switched the ones you wanted to solar panels, so they're still all on, so you have to like reset it. Like, go
now, is that
models.
It in terms of, or did you have to just go through and wipe them out in the Reddit file?
Either way.
Yeah.
You can do either way.
Yeah.
Or you can just set them to false and then reset them.
Can we do it that way?
You just have to set the, either way, go for it.
Okay, so... per that, I think we sort of have, yes, that funky behavior going on here. I'm going to go through and, again, just get rid of the curtain panels. Let's run that again. But we should be getting a list of trues, a list of falses, and all that kind of stuff. Let me show you the whole idea of doing this Boolean mask. It's another good way to do if you want to change something else besides, just kind of changing a true-false value. Let's see what we got. Okay, run completed there. Let's see what it looks like in the background.
Yeah, mine didn't show the link.
Well, that's not good. What's going on over here? See if I somehow messed up something else. Run panel with solar option. It looks like I have a bunch of panels there. Setting parameter by name, that's okay. What is missing? Something's missing in action. That certainly looks like it's creating a bunch of panels. What is going on? Make sure they're not hiding around somewhere weird. Nope. That's kind of very strange because I can see the panels right here. It created the panels and it's not showing them there. Let me try rerunning it again. I'm just a little confused. Yep, it says run completed again. Let's try this. I'm going to try. That's a really weird error. I'm going to try just changing him back to another panel type. Okay, that'll have some problems in that it doesn't have the solar option. We'll complain about that, but that's okay. I just want to see if I can get my panels back. I should have listened to George. Rerun them. Okay, let's see what's going on here.
Yeah, once you delete them, sometimes you have to like switch elements and then re-switch the elements.
Intriguing.
Doesn't like it.
It's almost being too smart for my own good. Okay, so I think I have now panels at least. Okay, let me switch them back again over here. The warning is because that other the solar thing wasn't there. Run that. Okay, so this, what we're doing here is really the essence of the first part of the assignment. You're just going to go through and, for your surface, go through and evaluate the directness and then, like that, change some parameters. Let's go ahead and let that finish. Let me give you the one other sort of little nuance on this kind of like searching, because it's useful too when you want to change something a little bit different. Okay. Oh, there we see. So I have my solar panels in the corner, okay, in the very direct, and then I have openness beyond it, okay, based on whatever threshold I'm going to do. Okay. Other things you can do, though, with this whole if sort of notion are, when you have a whole bunch of if values like this, what you can do is, as opposed to just directly sort of changing a value to true or false, you can sort panels out based on this. And there's a really useful node you need to know about that is based on this list of true false values. And it looks like this. It's Boolean filter by mask by Boolean filter. There it is. Oops, I saw it right there. Boolean filter.
Filter by bool mask.
Ah, thank you. Beautiful. Okay, so here's what this does. This function lets you take a list of true falses. That's the mask. Okay. It lets you take a list of elements. For example, our panel elements. Okay, and it sorts them into two categories. If you're in, that means you true, you met the mask. If you're out, you were false, you didn't meet the mask. Okay, so that's a useful thing. What this will do is it'll take our list of 120 panels and sort them into two pools, the ins and the outs. Okay, so where that's useful for, if, for example, you want to just eliminate the panels or switch to a different panel based on some criteria. If it's not something as easy as just sort of the turning on the true or false, it lets you go through and sort that. So the way this works is there's two lists now. My list of trues and my list of falses. And that's just sort of another very useful construct for you. Just, you know, ins versus out. Because for a lot of things you want to do, if it's above a certain threshold, if it's above a certain height, if it's just some sort of aspect you can sort of do a check on, you can then, you know, make that happen. So we can change that to a whole different type of panel or something. Okay, super. Let us wrap up on that. That's actually pretty good. And just switch to just another kind of couple simple examples. I'm sorry, I blasted through the kind of our normal break time. So. Is that okay? You gonna make it for the next 15? Okay.
Sorry. I don't know if the name of the node would make it.
What's that?
The name of the node, what is it?
It's list filter by Boolean mask. So list.filter.
Why does it call it in and out and not true or false?
That's a good question. You're sort of, you're in.
It's exclusive or something.
That is a little, I hadn't thought about
that
way.
The description is good. It says items whose mask index is true, items whose mask index is false.
There must be some history to why that is. Do you have a question? Yeah.
Yeah, so here your point would be if it's above a certain point, you'd want to like maybe totally shutter the window or something.
Yeah.
Like,
we could do something completely different. Something that couldn't be sort of a simple true-false operation.
Yeah.
We could, you know, turn the color off, or we could swap it in an entirely different panel or something like that. Okay, so we've learned a lot about sort of this whole notion of, where am I? Let's come back over here. Just kind of reading these directness values and trying to map different things to them. The next thing I want to sort of get into is really this whole notion of really how you can use these vectors to kind of do interesting little geometric things. There's an example 10.3, which is a really quick one. I'll just show that to you. Then we'll spend some more time on 10.4, of following the sun. And the idea of following the sun is that if the sun is moving through the sky, you could actually always have a vector that points to it and then make your panels always point to it, okay? Which is kind of a useful thing to think about doing. So if the sun moves through the sky at different times, we think about sometimes if we have solar panels on the roof as opposed to them being stationary, that they can sort of move so that they're always reorienting themselves so that they get the best orientation, the best kind of ability to collect the solar power. So that's what that one's about. Example 10.4 is really how you can sort of look at, just changing the size of a window overhang so that it's always optimally sized to sort of meet the sun's position. So they kind of dynamically change that. But let's go ahead and start with 10.3, and we'll see how that goes today. So in terms of 10.3, got pictures of screen desktops, and that's confusing me. Okay. 10.3, let's open that up. This is, again, a pretty simple example. It's really all about just kind of following the sun. And actually, let me take a, just to give you the brief overview of what's going on there. The idea is, in this one, we're going to create a grid of points. We've done that before, just using sort of code blocks, some point by coordinates. So we're just going to create a grid of points to place some things on. We're going to create some vectors that point from each of those points to the sun location. Okay. Then we're going to create some planes that follow that. So we're going to create some planes that always, they're normal to the vector point to the sun. Their origin is at the grid, but wherever the sun moves, that normal is always going to point to the sun. Then finally, we'll go ahead and put like little rectangles on there just so we sort of see those planes naturally. So if you go to 10.3, let's take a look at that. Opening up 10.3. This is actually sort of a simple little one, but kind of a really powerful capability. This kind of gets to everyone who wants to sort of have structures that use a little biomimicry and try to, you know, like a sunflower, like follow where the sun's location is, or you know, to start changing all their parameters. Okay, 10.3 just looks like a nice open field waiting to have some solar panels placed on it. We'll go to Dynamo and we'll add that in.
Vectors for the points. Why do you create a vector that starts at the point of the panel and goes to a point from the vector of the sun?
Ah, well, what we're going to do is we're going to represent where the sun is in the sky as a point. But let me open it and I'll show you. It's just sort of working within the mechanics of sort of the way they make the information available to us in Dynamo. Let's start back over here. Finish opening up. Okay. Let's start over here. So at the high level, yeah, we're just going to start back over here in the corner. We're going to create that grid of points. Most of you are pretty good on that. We're just going to basically have some points. It's going to go 0 to 20. Looks like that's going to be, I believe that is the 5 points along the way. 0 to 20 in both directions, point by coordinates. It's going to be a cross product, so I'm going to get, you know, an XY grid going in two directions. I'm going to flatten it so I have all the different points in a flat list. So that's going to be the start of where we're putting the origin points for the different solar panels. The sun's location, okay, here's the sun settings, red from Revit. We go ahead and get the vector, but then what I do is I return the vector as a single point, because the vector just has a distance, and what I really want is just kind of consider that to be an XYZ point. So that's how I say, here's the sun's location currently in the sky, and then making a vector between the points says, let's go ahead and from this grid of points, go through and take that point in the sky and make a series of vectors that connect between all these grid points and starting points and that sun location in the sky.
Right, but that's not giving the direct location to the sun. Because what you need to do is you need to add that vector. You need to add that vector point to the coordinates of this one.
Say that again.
So instead of going initial point to the vector point, because that's only the true vector from 0, 0, 0. when you turn that vector into a point. So what you need to do is you need to take the x, y, z coordinates of each of those and add that vector as point.
Oh, no, no, I understand.
You know what I'm saying?
Correct. This is really, this is like a cheap approximation. But no, you're correct in terms of the right way to do it. Because really, yeah, what's going to happen in here
so
is...
we're not calculating if the house is like a little bit away from the 0, 0, 0 part
yes,
point?
Yes, it's not considering that. It's not that, I don't think it's super challenging. We just would have, you know, do you understand what I'm saying though?
Yes.
Because when you turn that vector and take away its starting point, because really the vector is going from 0, 0, 0 to that point, is what you're saying. Because you're like flattening that vector to a point.
Yes.
And now that only the correct vector is from 0, 0, 0.
The absolutely correct, yes, correct. Now it's a little bit different. Although it's interesting in terms of the sun and the sky.
Well, you're talking because it's infinity, but it doesn't go to zero. It doesn't. I still think that there's a. Oh, okay, it's not important.
No. It's you're absolutely right in terms of the directness there. So, but this is just in terms of demonstrating the ability to follow something. Yeah, I think what you're saying it would be more accurate to do that. But if I just take these points, okay, and let's just do it this way first, and we'll. Make it better. Let's go ahead and run that. What should happen is, over here, in our dyno environment, I basically have now, like some vectors, I have, basically, this is just a single point in the sky. This is like this list of points is down on the ground. So this should be a whole bunch of different vectors, but let's see if it is or not. Okay, now we're not actually seeing anything there just yet. What I'm going to do is basically put some planes in there that are going to go through and kind of always be pointing in that direction. And how we do that is I'm just going to take the origins, all those original points, and then draw some planes that are normal to this vector. Let's see what happens over here. So in this scenario, if we go through and take a look at this, and we go zipping around over there, all these different planes are pointing to the same point. Yeah, they're off by a little, it's not truly accurate, okay, but they're all pointing at some sort of area, like in the sky right now. And the deal is, if we go through and move the sun in the sky, all those will point to, again, sort of the same pop that back over here. Okay. So right now they're all pointing in one area. If I move that later in the sky, let's say it's 5 p.m. instead. So sun's over there. Let's go ahead and run it over here. Hopefully all those little like guys are going to spin around. Beautiful. Hopefully pointing at that over there. So at a real simple level, just this idea of using vectors is kind of an okay approximation. In terms of creating rectangles and displaying these, what you can do is these are all just planes right there. If I want to go through and just sort of draw rectangles, which make it a little bit easier to see, I'm just going to draw a little 2x2 rectangle on that plane. Okay. And then if I want to use that rectangle to actually represent something that is actually going to be a surface, what I can do is take those rectangles and make some little surfaces. They'll actually show up in Revit too. So if I run that, come back over there. we now have a whole bunch of surfaces that again are approximating panels, but not really. Let's go back over here, I'll make it back to 10 a.m. And when I rerun that, the panels are now pointing over in that direction. Okay, now this is not accurate in the sense that, oh, as you look at all those panels, given that scale of what's going on, you know, there's not that big a variation. It's because of the funny little math error that I'm introducing there, because I'm pointing at a single point. So.
Yeah, I think it works really well when your x and y values are close to the origin.
Mm-hmm.
If those are close to zero. So I think if you took this grid and went like 0 to 200, for example, since
mm-hmm.
these sun values, if you look at the vectors, are like between 0 and 100. Because
mm-hmm.
Think about it, if you have the solar panel at the same x, y location as the vector, so
mm-hmm.
let's say it's 90, 17, and
mm-hmm.
you have 90, 17, then your vector is just going to be 0, 0.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning it's not going to be pointing
mm-hmm.
at the sun at all. It's just going to be pointing, you know what I'm saying? It'll
mm-hmm.
be pointing straight out.
Mm-hmm.
Your solar panel will be horizontal.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it works really well for this one. That's because like those are tracking really well. And I think it's because they're close to zero.
Yeah. So we should think about really how we have to sort of basically, you know, adjust the vector so it actually accounts for that a little bit better. Because we actually do have a vector over here. We have points over there. And really, because if we applied that same vector uniformly to the points, yeah, that would make them all just point straight up in the same direction. Well, I guess that would work.
All you have to do is add the vector. All you have to do is that vector point, those values.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is add those to the coordinates of the x, y, and z.
Okay.
So each of your solar panels, you just have to say x coordinate plus that vector point value.
But then it's really, but so you really want to do a vector add.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's how you do it. You just add them together.
Okay, so if the idea was, let's try this. Using the new improved logic, we're going to take the sun vector, and we're going to take all those points as vectors. What is it? Is it point as a vector? Let's try that.
Yeah.
So, in theory, I should be able to take all these points as vectors here and add those together. I can get a whole bunch of those vectors instead. So then, take this instead and use that. So now we're actually using the true vector. Okay, so what's happening in this case, which is actually more accurate, you see that everything's sort of pointing in that. In my example, what happened is because we weren't using the true vectors, we're using sort of this convergence on a single point. All the panels were sort of focused like on a single point, which is really not so accurate. This is better in that as you go ahead and pull out and have the same vector, they're still going to follow the sun, but they're all going to be planar or coplanar to each other because they're all going to use the same vector to go ahead and orient themselves, which is a good enhancement. So let's take a look at that. So thank you for giving me the quickest way to go through and do that. So basically over here in the same sense, blah, blah, blah. Zoom on out there. If I move the sun to like 12, should go ahead and get some nice, they're all sort of pointing in the right direction, but they're all using the same vector to kind of orient themselves, which is perfect. So thank you. That's actually a nice way to just go ahead and fix that example so it's a better reflection. This is sort of a simplification which has to converge, where this is actually the true behavior, so they're actually doing the true x vector to it. Okay, beautiful. Let us pause there for today in terms of what's going on. Next time we'll take on the issue of this little solar overhang. That's actually a pretty easy little guy in terms of depths and shades and geometry. But more importantly, next time we'll take on the issue of the solar analysis node, which gives us true insulation values as opposed to these directness values, which are approximations that are quick to compute, but not quite accurate enough. Okay, so I will look forward to seeing you next Tuesday. We're around later today in terms of playing around with anything finishing up assignment 3. And then just have a look at assignment 4. Look ahead and play with it a little bit. Okay, beautiful. Let us adjourn.